1280 AM Radio Montreal presenta a Onda Latina, la radio inteligente, la radio humana, pensando en ti. Música, poesía, autoconocimiento, deportes, cultura, noticias y mucho más. Tu Onda Latina, tu Onda Twins, tu Onda en Español. Escúchanos de lunes a viernes a partir de las 18:30 en CFMB 1280 AM en Onda Latina.
Personajes en Onda Latina.
Amigos, continuamos aquí en Onda Latina, nuestro espacio en español. Y por supuesto, tenemos, como comentábamos nosotros, uno de nuestros grandes ídolos y una personalidad, Sheldon Keegan. Vamos a dar una mirada a Sheldon Keegan antes de darle la bienvenida, quien tiene una larga carrera ilustre en el entretenimiento y producción en conciertos. Era evidente incluso de que a una temprana edad Keegan estaba destinado al éxito en el entretenimiento como emprendedor y hombre de negocios, y durante más de 4 décadas Sheldon Keegan ha sido una figura dominante en el entretenimiento, producción de conciertos y ferias de escena en Montreal. Él ha sido la fuerza impulsora detrás de un amplio espectro de proyectos de éxito, desde conciertos, solteros, fiestas de bodas, exposiciones para la novia, la familia, los boomers, el mercado de empresas. Bueno, pues iniciando a una edad muy joven en el entretenimiento, y la historia que más me ha conmovido la vamos a presentar después de darle la bienvenida a nuestro querido invitado Sheldon Keegan con nosotros aquí en Onda Latina. Hi, Sheldon, how are you?
Ah, good evening. I'm doing fine, thank you. Nice to talk to you.
Thank you very much for being with us tonight. And I was just mentioning in Spanish a little bit about the fabulous background after this 50 years in the business and the moving story that once you were listening at the age of 14 years old, the radio, you fell in love with that radio. I mean, all hosts, the radio, as myself, we would love to have somebody like you and always calling to win these LPs. And after that, when you won these so many LPs that you decided to become a DJ, or how did you got involved with all this music aspect?
Well, that's it. I used to listen to radio, and the radio announcer had 4 different phone numbers. And believe it or not, all these years later, phone number 279-4568, I still remember the phone numbers. And what happened is you would do a contest saying, you know, what's the latest song that the Beatles just put out? And I would keep track that he had used 3 of his phone numbers, so he'd be now going to use the 4th one. And I had a rotary phone, so I would dial 279-456, and he said, dial the number. I would dial the 8, and then he said, oh my God, not Sheldon Keegan. I can't believe he's here again. So that's how I started to win the records, and I won trips to meet the Beatles. I met the Rolling Stones, and then I said, you know, music, this is great, this is fun, I want to entertain. So when I was 15, I decided I was going to be a disc jockey. I was still going to school. My parents wanted me to continue in school, but I had this passion saying, no matter what, I am going to be a disc jockey. So at that age, I decided the only way for me to achieve this was to go on my own. So I quit school, and I, believe it or not, ran away from home and started on my own. I had a 3.5-room apartment, and it was interesting, to say the least. It wasn't easy, but I knew that's what I wanted to do, and I mean, I never looked back. Okay. Disc jockey, and then I started to get work. I would call different places and say, hey, look, my name is Shelley the K. I'm a DJ. I'm ready to come to your party. And at that time, it was unheard of because everybody was having bands and orchestras. And I said, look, you know, I'm going to come to your party. I'm going to charge you $50. It's going to be fun. You guys are going to have a great time. And people accepted. And after a while, I was so booked that I got 1 more DJ and then 2 more DJs. And at one point, I had 6 other DJs and me. And then I started finding bands. And then I was able to do 11 parties in one night. So I did that for some years. And then I said, how can I get more business for my DJ company? How can I get more weddings? So I came up with the idea to do something called Salon de la Mariée, which is a wedding show that's taking place this weekend. And the first show I did was in 1980, and it's 35 years later. It's going on, and it was a great way to get more work. So in the meantime, you know, I was so involved with music, I said, let's see what I can do. So in the late 60s, I contacted Place des Arts, and I was able to book a date, and then I got my first show with Dizzy Gillespie and Gene Krupa at Place des Arts. And I was, and could very well still be, the youngest promoter ever to do a show at Place des Arts. So I started this string of concerts, somewhat well, some, you know, didn't go so well, but it's something I wanted to do. And it was really interesting then because there was no internet. You couldn't sort of Google an artist and find out who the agent was. So I had to just really do the legwork and find out how to reach these different artists, you know, mostly in the United States and some in Europe. So that's when I became an impresario. And in the 60s and 70s, I did a whole slew of shows, you know, Ravi Shankar, Dizzy, you know, Buddy Rich, Woody Herman, George Benson, a lot of performers. Was really interesting, you know, lots of unique experiences. And it became like another complete division of Sheldon Kagan International. So there was the entertainment company, which was the DJs and bands. There was the first trade show, which was Salon de la Mariée, and the concerts, mostly at Place des Arts. Those are, you know, what I've been doing right now, and this January is my 50th anniversary in business. It's been a really great ride. You know, I've achieved just about everything that I want to do. It's a lot of fun.
Sheldon, I wanted our listeners get that glimpse that you were the one that started with the mobile discotheque.
That's it.
You know, in the 80s, it was fantastic.
I was definitely the first mobile disc jockey. And it's really interesting because I started to do Italian weddings and even Spanish weddings and Greek weddings and Jewish weddings, but the Italian weddings especially, it always had bands. And, you know, when I started doing these big Italian weddings, you know, some of the parents were concerned, saying, look, this guy, Sheldon Kagan, he's really good, but what are our friends going to think when we tell them we're having a disc jockey instead of an orchestra? But, you know, the bride and grooms were sort of saying, look, Mom, Dad, you know, it's our party. We want to make it really fun. And I remember doing an Italian wedding one day, one of my first Italian weddings, and I asked everyone to come up on the dance floor, and I was going to do a tarantula instead of a tarantella. And they all sort of giggled, and it took me like about 30 seconds to realize what I had just said. But I mean... You know, I adapted to everything. So when it came to the weddings, you know, I just found what the people wanted to hear, gave them what they wanted to hear. But also I do lots of games and animation, and I'm constantly thinking of new kinds of concepts, what we can do to make it entertaining and fun for everybody.
The youth, it was never a problem for you in the sense that when you contacted the managers of different groups, you were so young, and they didn't believe in you.
For sure. No, it definitely was an issue. I remember one man that I dealt with for many years, after probably five times booking his performers, you know, he said, look, Sheldon, you know, I'd love to meet you. I'm in New York, and I'd like you to come and see me. But I didn't want to see him because I was probably, I don't know, maybe 20, 21 years old at that time. So I put it off a couple of times. And then he finally got back to me, you know, a few months later. And he said, look, just pick a couple of days you want to come. I'm going to send you your plane tickets. I'm going to have you picked up at the airport. We're going to pick you up at a hotel, and we're going to meet. And that's what I did. I remember, you know, getting on the plane and flying first class to New York and getting picked up in a limo and staying at this fancy hotel. And then the next morning I had my meeting in his office, and I walked into his office, and I'm sure what he wanted to say was, well, son, how come your father couldn't make it? Because he had no idea how young I was. And we had a great time. We went to the jazz clubs, and we became friends. And, you know, probably for 10, 15 years after that, I kept dealing with the same person. So at the beginning, you know, I was a bit self-conscious about my age, but I felt very comfortable in what I was doing. And it really wasn't a problem. But it's something that I just had to, you know, handle and do it the right way.
This is why your advice to a lot of entrepreneurs, a lot of people with that passion, you're an example for them. And I like to share with our listeners some of the concerts that I love. ABBA Memories, for example, the Commodores, Frank D'Angelo, Dionne Warwick, the International Tenors, among others.
Really, really funny story about Dionne Warwick. I brought her to Montreal, you know, maybe 3 years ago, and they were playing the night before in Toronto, so we arranged. They decided that instead of flying in, they were going to take the train because it takes almost the same amount of time, you know, between going through planes and and whatnot. So we had all these specifications in the rider. Dionne Warwick gave us a rider, meaning approximately 40 pages of what she wanted over and above the actual contract itself, right down to the kind of champagne she wanted and the crystal ashtrays and the color of the limousines, and very, very, very detailed. So my son Barry went down to pick her up at Windsor Station, and he called me, you know, shortly after they arrived, and he said, "Dad, I got sort of good news and bad news." He said, "Dionne Warwick and all her entourage have arrived at the train station, but nobody can find Dionne. She's missing." And what had happened is, Dionne is a huge cigarette smoker. So because she couldn't smoke for the five-hour train ride, when she got to downtown Montreal, she left the train station, went onto La Gauchetière, and couldn't find her way back into the train station. And her cell phone was dead. So literally it took maybe half an hour until we sort of realized where she was. And that was sort of Dionne Warwick in Montreal. Dionne really ended up being a pleasure to work with. I had Oliver Jones and Rennie Lee on opening acts. And at the end of the night at Place des Arts, she said, "You know, Mr. Kagan, you and your son and your family have been such a pleasure to deal with." She said, "I deal with many, many impresarios, and some of them it's all about the money and they don't care about the performers, and you're just really genuine." So I said, "Thank you." And I said, "Now that you're being so nice and talking about how great we are, maybe you can do me a favor." I said, "Your relative is Whitney Houston, and I'd love to try and bring her to Montreal." And she said, "Well, you know, Sheldon, Whitney's going through a lot of problems," she said, "but, you know," she said, "it could be really interesting if you were to bring her to Place des Arts rather than play in Chicago or New York or L.A. where all the press is." And I said, "Look, let's see what you can do." And she said, "Well, I'll be in New Jersey in 2 months, and I'm going to speak to Whitney and see what I can do." Shortly after that, my wife Linda and I were in Jamaica on vacation, and my son Barry got me on my Skype, and he said, "Dad, any chances of bringing Whitney to Montreal or down the tubes? You better go turn on CNN." And of course, you know, Whitney had died.
Oh,
so, I mean, that was, you know, quite the story. And if you saw the funeral of Whitney Houston, it was all done by Dionne Warwick. And, you know, I can't say today that Whitney was going to come work for us for Montreal, but I think there was a good chance that could have happened. So that was just really, really tragic.
It is true that through our life we meet different and interesting personalities. And besides Dionne Warwick...
And I had, you know, 2 years ago I brought the Commodores to Montreal, which is a group that was originally with Lionel Richie, and we had a gas with them. They were just so fun and just, you know, most of the performers were really good to work with. In the early years, I dealt with, like, a lot of the big bands, you know, the Buddy Riches and the Woody Hermans, and Dave Brubeck, who you played at the beginning, still one of my favorite songs, Take Five. I brought him to Montreal 3 times, you know, once with his son Darius, and also I was involved in a jazz festival at sea with Duke Ellington Orchestra and Dave Brubeck. So it was just amazing to spend, you know, my early years meeting these performers that have such a history. It's unbelievable.
And the love that you created among the entertainment business. But going further to an entrepreneur and a businessman, once you decided to do these concerts, you started with all these, like you mentioned, the Salon de la Maria came hand by hand with the DJ aspect because it was part of your business. But then you created these other trade shows. Where did you get the idea for these other trade shows?
Well, I was reading in the media all about this term baby boomers. And, you know, baby boomers have more money than any other generation in Canada's history. So I came up with the idea to do an event called Salon de Baby Boomers Plus, which I did for 4 years at the Palais des Congrès. And it was hugely successful the first year. And then after that, the numbers had gone down each year. The boomers were sort of feeling that they don't want to be labeled as boomers. You know, they just were feeling if you're a boomer, you're sort of on your way out. So after, you know, the third year, I decided I would just do it for one more year, and then that would be it. You know, so the timing, you know, made sense to just let it slide.
But then you have the Salon d'Affaires also, which is
a business show, and then I have an idea for Salon de Famille, which is something for parents and kids. So you have to look ahead and always try and come up with ideas and reinvent yourself.
This is how great that being just in love with music, being just a DJ at the music, at a young age you decided that you could do much more of what you were actually doing. You were very promising entrepreneur and business visionary in the sense of creating all these different activities since you met so many people. And this Salon de la Marie, it has had been like for the last 35 years, where you were mentioning, a huge success.
That's right. It's a trade show that features, as I call it, everything under one roof for your wedding, honeymoon, and future home. So I have all kinds of suppliers there. You know, I've got bridal gowns and tuxedos and jewelers and florists, event planners, reception halls, caterers. You know, I have photographers, video, honeymoon destinations, officiants. So it's really everything a couple can look for. And when a couple are planning, you know, their wedding, it's the biggest day in their life. So, you know, there's a lot of pressure, there's a lot of anxiety. So when they come to my show, they meet all these suppliers, they can see them face to face, talk with them, understand who they are, what pricing they are, see if they feel comfortable with them. So there's also fashion shows, and I'm very careful to have the models look more like a bride-to-be than have, you know, sort of like the highest fashion model. You know, everybody should see what they're going to look like in their gowns. So the fashion shows are really, really important, you know. And then I have, like, great entertainment, of course. You know, I've got Raphael going to be coming down to perform. I have another lady called Sandy Tuberville, who's a dish jockey, producer, singer. I've got the Crescent Street Circus, which is, you know, in a way something like a Cirque du Soleil. They're going to do all kinds of things. One of them is going to be hanging from a trapeze and actually pouring champagne for the guest. So there's so much going on. You know, you get to learn. There's food sampling taking place where you can try different samples from the caterers to, again, see if that suits you. It's really fun. And as I said, this is the 35th year, so it's, you know, who does something for 35 consecutive years? It even took place during the ice storm, barely. So this is on from 10 to 5 this Saturday and Sunday, and it's at the Palais des Congrès, and it's really a spectacular event. There's 170 kiosks. I'm going to have probably, you know, well over 5,000 visitors over the 2 days, and you can walk up the aisles and talk to people, and as it's sample and learn, and then you go to the other room, and it's going to have the continuous entertainment and the fashion shows, which is really, really a lot of fun.
And we wanted to thank you because you allow Rafael and Eje Dominicana, who has been a great success among the Latin American community with his passion, to be present, to open the doors for the new generation, also from our community, the Latin American community, that you believe so much on us.
No, it's great. We're all literally, in the wee hours of the morning, I head down there with my son and my team. It's quite interesting how we do this here because the room is close to 50,000 square feet. So the room is all empty. And then the first people that come in sort of set up the draping, and then the rentals come in, and then I go in with Barry and my staff to make sure that everything is copacetic. And then as of 8 o'clock, all the limos come in. So that's all happening tomorrow morning. And then 10 o'clock, the vendors come in. So from 10 to 7, it's like a full day of all the, you know, exhibitors setting up their booths. The bands are there doing sound tests. The fashion people are doing their walk on the runway. Then everything closes at 7 o'clock. And then, bang, Saturday morning, it all opens and it's showtime.
I want to remind our listeners that it's going to be Saturday, January 31st and February 1st.
That's it. This weekend.
From 10 to 5, you know, more over 5,000 visitors, and the whole work that you have. After the event, I'm sure that you're going to be going to relax on a beach. Maybe you're going to have a second honeymoon. Sheldon?
It's interesting because the show always takes place on Super Bowl weekend, but it doesn't affect my show at all because the showtime finishes at 5, and most of the visitors, you know, leave around 4, and Super Bowl doesn't take place till, you know, 6 o'clock pre-show anyway. So it's funny because the grooms come, you know, with the brides, but the brides are always much more interested in the grooms. And, of course, the grooms are just gathering around in corners talking about, you know, who's going to win Super Bowl. And then the bride will, you know, bride-to-be will look at them and they'll say, oh, yes, honey, that looks really great. I think you look really good in that dress. It's fun for me to watch this. And every year, 2, 3, sometimes 4 couples are proposed to at the actual show, too, which is really fun to see also. So it's really a show that, you know, talks about love and happiness. And 2 years ago, we openly welcomed same-sex weddings, and that's been really well received. And it's something that, you know, should have been done, you know, even before. It was always there, but now, you know, I get a lot of gay and lesbian couples, and they're really happy to be there. And, you know, even some of the cake, you know, companies, you know, when they're doing their toppers, you used to also see a bride and groom, but now sometimes you'll see two grooms or two brides. So, you know, times have changed, and I try and keep up with the times and, you know, do what I feel is right for everybody in all communities.
All the stories that we have heard about the Salon de la Marie, like I mentioned, the first time I came here just to prepare my wedding 22 years ago, imagine. That was the first time I met with your team and with the Salon de la Marie, and I was so amazed that something like that could be open. I said, what a great idea.
Yeah, it really is. It's for me, I'm very close to that. My son, Barry, and Marlene were literally, as soon as they can walk, they were in the fashion show. And I'm going to actually bring some posters and put them up this weekend of Barry and Marlene when they were probably 2 and 3 years old walking down the runway. And now they're 26 and 28. And Marlene has a son, Turner. And Turner, who's 16 months, will be, for his first time, of course, in Salon de la Marie as a model in a tuxedo Saturday and Sunday. So it's really nice that, you know, that we keep the whole family tradition.
It is a family business, that's right, and the love and the passion that you have put on it. And let me tell you, Sheldon, that I see a book in your hands.
Oh, no, that's the next step for sure.
I hope to have
be doing next year some sort of a speaking tour where I'm going to go out and talk to kids and people and whoever I think is, you know, are the right people that could be interested in talking about motivation and what to do. And definitely the book is next. I have so many stories. I mean, I could sit on the phone with you for 24 hours and I wouldn't, you know, I wouldn't even get through a portion of what's happened and all the experiences that I've collected. So it'll be fun. I put together all kinds of video footage. So I'm going to do some sort of a video also. But the book definitely, you know, the book should happen, you know, in 2015.
Fantastic. I love when you say I'm giving back to the community what the community gave me. At this time, after 50 years in the business, we congratulate you. It's an honor to speak with you, Sheldon, and thank you for speaking with us here in Onda Latina.
Yeah, and thank you very much. I'm really happy to spend this time with you.
Y bien, amigos, vamos a recordarles que Rafael Energía Dominicana se va a presentar el sábado 31 de enero y domingo 1 de febrero. Como comentaba ahorita Sheldon, de 10 a 5 de la tarde es el sábado y domingo. Va a estar presente en el Palacio del Congreso, Salón de la Boda. Así es que Salón de la Marie, no se pierdan este sábado y domingo, 35ª edición de este show. Sheldon, thank you very much and have a pleasant night.
Great, thank you. You too and all your listeners. Come and check out the Salón de la Marie this weekend.
We'll do so and we'll be there for sure this weekend with you.
Good, we'll see you there.
Gracias, Sheldon. Extraordinario personaje que tenemos, Sheldon Kagan, como comentábamos, desde una idea clara de la música hasta conciertos, productor y ahora, bueno, pues con este gran empresario poniendo a todos a nuestro y dando la oportunidad a nuestra comunidad latinoamericana de presentarse. Gracias, gracias. Realmente un gran placer y continuamos aquí en Onda Latina. MB 1280 AM Radio Montreal presenta a Onda Latina, la radio inteligente, la radio humana, pensando en ti. Música, poesía, autoconocimiento, deportes, cultura, noticias y mucho más. Tu Onda Latina, tu Onda Twins, tu Onda en Español. Escúchanos de lunes a viernes a partir de las 18:30 en CFMB 1280 AM en Onda Latina.